Everything we enjoy will be tainted with blood.
Everything we enjoy will be tainted with blood.
one in scriptural codes, teacher engages in an abominable action, has lost the sense of discrimination, is fit to be abandoned. Bhishma and Drona were obliged to take the side of Duryodhana because of his financial assistance, although they should not have accepted such positions simply on financial considerations. Under the circumstances, they have lost the respectability of teachers. Arjuna thinks that nevertheless, they remain the superiors, and therefore to enjoy material profits after killing them would mean to enjoy spoils tainted with blood. So the text again, Guru Anahatva Yimahadubhavan, Shreyo Bhoktum Vaikshavati Loke, Advartakaman Suguru Mihaiva, Unjaya Bhogan, Rudira Bhagdidan. It would be better to live in this world by begging than but to live at the cost of the lives of great souls for my teachers. Even though desiring worldly gain, they are superiors, for they have killed everything we enjoy will be tainted with blood. Om Vishnu Praya Krishna Prasthai Kuzve Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Tanamare Namaste Sarasutundeve Gauravani Vacharane Nirvishesha Shunivade Pasya Adhyade Siddharane. The Bhagavad Gita deals with basically two aspects of knowledge, namely knowledge of the self and knowledge of the Supreme Self. But we also find that there is elements in the Bhagavad Gita to deal with practical living in the material world, which means culture, the culture of, that leads to self-realization. Culture is supposed to lead to self-realization. That's why it's culture, to become a human being. In one place, Prabhupada says, Brahminical consciousness, a Brahminical level of existence, is the beginning of human life. Which means that, except for the Brahmins, everyone else is practically less than a human. Of course, in other places we find that if one becomes even a Vaishya or a Kshatriya, one is twice born, because there is some avenue of following the instructions coming from the higher authorities. But in the culture we call the Veda culture, there is an element of superior, which has mostly been lost among so-called civilizations. The idea that anyone is superior, even the father or the mother is superior, even that has been lost. What to speak of teachers? We pay the teachers, and after we learn something from them, we forget about them. Then we become the teacher. And whatever we learn from our previous teachers is all ours, and we forget about the teacher. So there is an element of impersonalism built into modern society. And because the knowledge that generally we get, we don't have any gratitude for it. We think I deserve it. Therefore, generally we don't apply it very nicely. In the Vedic civilization, everyone who gives us superior knowledge is considered to be guru. And in ISKCON society, generally we only take guru as the initiating spiritual master, which is a nice sentiment. But that's probably what it is a sentiment. Or, at worst, it's a incomplete understanding of actually even what spiritual guru means. In other words, if we understand that spiritual means we're connected with Krishna, and that's what makes it spiritual, is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. And what is that connection with Krishna? It's not that we're ever outside of a connection with Krishna. Just like, even if one is a prisoner, then one is still in a jail, which is situated in the state. You can't be outside the state, Even if you're rebellious, still you're managed by the state. So although we're rebellious against Krishna, we can't be outside of Krishna because we're 100% eternally depending upon him. Since he's in control of everything, therefore we can't do anything without him. We can forget him and therefore suffer in that forgetfulness, but it doesn't mean that we're suddenly outside of Krishna. We're outside of Krishna's jurisdiction. We may be being beaten by the material energy to correct us, but that doesn't mean the material nature is acting independently. It's acting under Krishna's direction. Therefore, even in the beating of the material nature, we can't complain because it's ultimately Krishna sanctioning it because he knows it'll help us make some advancement in spiritual life. Therefore, Brahmarpanam, Brahmahayavir, Bhagavata, Sangasya, Muktasya, Jnanavasti, Chetasaha, Ejacharata, Karma, Samagram, Pravilite. The work of a person is unattached to the modes of material nature and is fully situated in transcendental knowledge, emerges entirely into transcendence. So, superior knowledge coming from superior teachers is meant as give us that understanding. Gata sangasya muktasya jnanavasti chetasa jacharata karma samagram pravilite. The work of a person is unattached to the modes of material nature. In other words, it's difficult to become unattached to the modes of material nature, and it's not expected that suddenly we're going to be able to do it. But it is expected that we should make some progress in doing that. So, unattached to the modes of material nature, at least foundationally, we have to understand our eternal spiritual soul. I'm not this body. And our method of becoming unattached to the modes of nature is somehow or another to understand the philosophy, which I said is ultimately quite simple. Everything belongs to Krishna. That has to be the basis of our whatever we're doing, and then to find out what Krishna wants us to do through Guru, Sadhana, and Shastra. And then to do it to please Krishna, consciously to do it to please Krishna, which means ultimately, well, we should be thinking that that's why I'm doing it, is to please Krishna. If we don't think I'm doing it to please Krishna, then we must be doing it for some other reason. We're not the International Society for Krishna Unconsciousness. For the society to become conscious of Krishna. And then what we do, what will be the result? What are we actually looking for? That when my name is chanted by the devotees, they go, God. Oh, it's all right. I'm just too humble. Don't do it again. God, oh, I'm so humble. What are we actually looking for? We're actually looking so we think about Krishna. That's the highest perfection of life, is to think about Krishna, not superficially, but ultimately one can gradually come to the platform of not only remembering Krishna's form, but actually feeling his presence. And feeling Krishna's presence is the nature of spiritual pleasure. And that spiritual pleasure is ultimately what purifies us of any other of our material conceptions and our material experience. So that's the formula. Accept everything here belongs to Krishna, including myself. Find out what Krishna wants me to do with his energies. Engage them in his service to please him with determination. And then the result is our reward is that we'll be able to think about Krishna. Tad buddhiyas tad atmanas tad nishtas tad parayanaha gajanya puna arvitim jnanani dutta kalmasha. Oh, one's faith, refuge, mind, and intelligence are all fixed in the Supreme, and one becomes fully cleansed of all misgivings through complete knowledge and thus proceeds straight on the path of self-realization. So, unattached to the modes of nature by not becoming deviated by the impulses arising from our senses. becoming deviated from Krishna consciousness by our material conceptions and desires. That means that we're unattached. And then by we can do that if we're doing something positive. And as Gata Sangasi Muktasya, one is unattached to the modes of material nature and is fully situated in transcendental knowledge. So this is the art we're trying to become expert at, is seeing things with transcendental knowledge. Then when we look at things, they won't pierce our heart with either material lamentation or material desire. Everything that we're looking, anything that a materialist looks at in the material world, either pierces his, to different degrees, pierces his heart with material desire, or pierces his heart with lamentation. That's the only things that we're experiencing. So if we're situated in transcendental knowledge, then we'll become immune to this piercing of the heart by material conceptions. Even our dreams were becoming affected by lamentation and by hankering. And then, when our consciousness is actually spiritual, then we'll actually become, our consciousness will become spiritualized. Brahmarpanam brahmahayavir brahmagno brahmahutam brahmayavatena gantavya brahmakarmasamay dina. The work of a person is unattached to the material nature and is fully situated in transcendental knowledge, merges entirely into transcendence. For him, Brahmana is the offering, Brahmana is the sacrifice, the oblation, the chant. In other words, the perfection of life is to see everyone and everything in relation to Krishna. It's not just a theoretical understanding. But when actually comes to the platform, one can see how wonderful everything is. And the senses are purified. Everyone will look beautiful. Everything will seem wonderful. Not that everything is equally wonderful. When one sees someone suffering, one will think, wow, that's wonderful. I'm so glad you're suffering. Now that wonder is that how merciful the material nature is to cause the suffering to help inspire this living entity to stop his sinful activities so he can take shelter of Krishna. So the self-realized soul is not happy to see others unhappy, but he understands that their unhappiness is caused by their unwillingness to accept Krishna consciousness. And therefore the self-realized soul knows that the solution for their unhappiness is to help them become Krishna conscious. But he also knows that he can't force anyone to become Krishna conscious. All he can do is show by an example, and if those who are receptive, give them some instructions how to do that. But he knows that Maya also means mercy, and therefore he doesn't criticize Krishna or the material nature for subjecting someone to misery. He knows that it's all ultimately for their benefit, although he knows what their ultimate benefit is and would like to bestow it upon them. In any case, everything appears sukham, purna sukha sukhayate. Purna, vishvam purna sukhayate. The whole world seems wonderful. It seems not different from the spiritual world. Well, that's a very advanced stage of consciousness, but that's the state of consciousness that we're coming to. We shouldn't assume that right now I'm experiencing reality. We should assume that right now I'm in a state of illusion, I'm in a dream-like state, and therefore I should try to come to a higher state of consciousness where I can actually experience the wonder of reality, Krishna consciousness. So in order to do that, we take shelter of Guru. Now in the material world, there's Gurus who are materially elevating us by giving us knowledge of how the material nature works. And in the Veda culture, people are quite appreciative, even as such gurus. They respected them. And generally said gurus were actually giving spiritual knowledge, in one sense, because they were teaching, according to the Varna Ashram, because the instructions from Varna and Ashram come from Krishna, Therefore, they're an indirect way of serving Krishna. But because Varnashram is not by itself with the idea of simply to please Krishna, but it's to obtain either knowledge or renunciation, material knowledge or renunciation, in order to live more peacefully and happily in this world. Therefore, because it takes Krishna, it's being done under Krishna's guidance, therefore it's considered to be spiritual, but not fully spiritual. The whole idea of all the Vedic literature is Jagat by Vishnu. Everyone in the Vedic culture knows they have to satisfy Vishnu in order to get any result. And therefore, at least they follow Krishna's instructions, if not out of love, but at least out of duty. But higher than that is transcendental knowledge, where we understand that not only we have to serve Krishna out of duty, but we also have to serve Krishna out of love to get the highest benefit. So for that, there is also gurus who are teaching that. But as I said, we may learn the art of, as Arjuna's case, of military art he learned from his teachers, Bhishma and Drona. So they're a guru for him. But they're not teaching, not everyone that they come in contact with, they have to serve through the military art. So that Arjuna, every time he looks at someone, tries to figure out whether or not he should shoot him or not, or hit him over the head with a club. To apply the art of these particular gurus are applied in a very specific circumstances. But spiritual knowledge is universal. In other words, actual spiritual knowledge, the knowledge we get, is applied 24 hours a day, everywhere, for all time. It's absolute knowledge. While the other knowledge may be temporary, oh, will be temporary, according to time, place, and circumstance. Even spiritual knowledge is applied, but according to time, place, and circumstance, material knowledge is also applied, but one is applied all the time, and the other is applied under certain circumstances. For instance, Arjuna applied time, place, and circumstance when he was exercising military art, and therefore if there was a warrior fleeing, he wouldn't hit him in the back with an arrow, hopefully. But spiritual knowledge is a constant factor that one has to apply all the time. But according to time, place, and circumstance also. As long as one is in the material world, one has to act appropriately, even when one is applying spiritual knowledge. Therefore, Śrīla Rūpa Gosvāmī said in his book that even if one becomes self-realized, externally one acts as a neophyte, although within oneself one thinks of his relation with Krishna in one of those rasas. In other words, one is acting in the spiritual world, as we find in some of our Goswami's literature, especially Brihad Bhagavatam. Well, in Brihad Bhagavatamrita, Gokumara is meditating on Gopal. But in a book like Vilapa Kusamanjari by Raghunath Das Goswami, we find he's acting in the spiritual identity, at times engaged in the pastimes of Radha and Krishna in Goloka Vrindavan. So internally, if one is self-realized, one can do that, but externally one still acts as a neophyte devotee in this world and serves Krishna according to time, place, and circumstance. And one has to honor those gurus also. So the job, the service of the initiating guru is not simply that to teach everyone how that he's in the disciplic succession and that you should honor and worship him, but the honor and worship that goes to the initiating guru is supposed to be distributed, or in other words, the faith that's developed in the initiating guru is supposed to be distributed so that one can repose appropriate faith in every other devotee, to see those devotees who are more advanced than we are and to take them, their instructions, as their being a representative of Krishna. And to honor them in the same way as a representative of Krishna. And to take those who are the same level of spiritual advancement as us, and to try to cooperate and appreciate them, serve them, but under the guidance of the superior devotee. And for those who are neophytes, who are asking for our instruction, we try to give them the understanding of our realization. And for those who are sahajiyas, we respect them within our minds, but we don't intimately associate with them. We don't criticize them, we don't deride them, unless you give me class. And then for the edification, for the instruction of others, we may do such things. But not out of envy, but out of warning devotees not to associate with them intimately and get entangled in their false conceptions or their misconceptions. In any case, bhakti is only dealing with love. There's nothing else in bhakti except for love. But how to properly show love has to be learned on the superior guidance. But there's no enviness, there's no hatred, there's no misconceptions in bhakti. And that's where neophyte devotees, when we put our own envious conditioning into bhakti, and we think that's part of bhakti, due to our illusion. So therefore, we have to be very careful that we don't become misdirected, even by the persons, even by our leaders, who we're taking as perfect. We have to always judge by our previous acharyas, everyone's activities. Our previous acharyas go all the way back to Lord Chaitanya and ultimately to Krishna's instructions, which Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is manifesting in this age through the instructions of Śrīla Rūpa Gosvāmī. So if I'm taking some, for an extreme example, just like there's one person who's going around now in the world claiming that he's his followers are claiming he's an incarnation of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu or someone. And he said that Prabhupada was an Abhraganuga Bhakti, but he couldn't. People weren't advanced enough to manifest. He couldn't manifest himself as a Raghunuga Bhakta because people couldn't understand. But now the devotees have become more advanced, and now he's come. And therefore, he has men and women. They all embrace each other and touch each other and whatever. But the proof that they're on Raghunuga Bhakti is that they're not having illicit sex. At least not public. So people, they have faith. This is a Mahabharata. We must follow him. They'll go to hell following him. Because it's completely out of line with Prabhupada's teachings. So we have to be careful that we know Prabhupada's teachings or else we'll get misdirected. At least in our society, we may have many Mahabhagavas, but so far the GBC has not recognized anyone as a Mahabhagava, nor have we seen anyone on the level of Śrīla Prabhupāda spreading Krishna consciousness. Therefore, we have to be, when we accept initiation into the ISKCON society, we're not just accepting initiation into a particular guru. We're accepting initiation into a system that Śrīla Prabhupāda has set up. Otherwise, we'd be bypassing Prabhupāda's instructions. He set up a GBC and temple presidents and so many authority structures. And to think that they're any less than the initiating guru in their instructions, not that they may not be on the same level as a spiritual advancement, but if they're giving us instructions coming through the disciples of succession, then their instructions are as good as Krishna's instructions, as good as our initiating spiritual master's instructions. And if we don't believe it, then there's a line of authority coming all the way up to the GBC, and the GBC is a body, not necessarily just individual GBCs. And the body may be imperfect, but then again, our initiating spiritual masters and all our other spiritual guides are meant to try to help us understand what the instructions are and how to properly apply them. So this is a little complicated, but life is complicated. And the GBC and the initiating gurus, as Prabhupada writes or spoke, we look at his conversations, they're all supposed to be, their aim, the reason why, the purpose that we're here, we're existing, is to become Krishna conscious. Apply the teachings of Śrīla Rūpa Gosvāmī in our lives, and fulfill the mission of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu didn't want a whole bunch of bhajana nandis sitting around looking at their navel and chanting Hare Krishna. He wanted to spread Krishna consciousness. That's why he personally came. Otherwise, he could have sat in the Jambura and just looked at his navel, chanting Hare Krishna. But he sent his devotees, Vandijananda, who's his first expansion everywhere to spread Krishna consciousness. A whole Panchatattva was spreading Krishna consciousness. His devotees were spreading Krishna consciousness. So any leader, whether they're managerial or spiritual, however we want to look at it, it's all spiritual. Because the whole aim is to spread Krishna consciousness. One problem in ISKCON that I've observed, at least, is that the managers think, well, I'm not a spiritual manager. I'm not supposed to spread Krishna consciousness. It's the job of the gurus to do that. I'm just to make sure that there's enough prasadam for everybody. That's what Prabhupada didn't want at all. And then the spiritual masters get overwhelmed. They have so many disciples. And they're supposed to tell everyone what to do. As if they were the super soul. Or as Indradu Maharaj told me one time, he said, we were talking about something like this. And he said, yes, I just gave initiation. And one of, well, and my disciple walked up to me, as I said this before, he said, Guru Maharaj, he said, can you tell me what my name means? I said, what name did I give you? So he said, Krishna Das. You don't understand. And then another disciple came to him and he gave Indradu Maharaj a donation. And Indradu Maharaj said, thank you very much. He said, what's your name? He said, Guru Maharaj, you don't know what my name is? And Indradu Maharaj said, no, you're my disciple? He said, yes. He said, you don't know my name? So Indradu Maharaj said, I'm not omniscient. He said, you're not omniscient? Could I talk to you later, Guru Maharaj? Can I get the donation back? No, he didn't say that. So it is not that the job of the spiritual master is to be the super soul. And that unless the spiritual master tells you something, initiating guru, it can't be as good as anyone else telling you something. So that if you keep that attitude, not only no one will survive as an initiating guru if they get too many disciples. So at least they won't be able to even chant their rounds. They won't have any time. Everyone's going to call up from around the world, Guru Maharaj, can I take prasadam? Guru Maharaj, can I take prasadam? Guru Maharaj, I want to get married. Tell me if this girl is good. Let me look at my crystal ball. Okay. And that way our society will never grow. And we make sure that unless the instruction is 100% sure it's coming from Krishna, then we'll never be able to do anything. We ask people to chant 16 rounds, are you sure it's coming from Krishna? Are you sure Krishna told me to ask you to chant 16 rounds? Prabhupada's books, we have to read, hear Krishna's instructions, hear from the, and then use our intelligence also to have a little faith that there are other devotees other than my initiated spiritual master who are actually giving us Krishna's instructions. It's not that Krishna is only in one person's heart, and somehow or another he never got the time to get into anyone else's heart. And even if he's there, although people may look like they're devotees, but they're only pretending. I'm quite sure they're not here. Although apparently it looks like they're doing something in Krishna consciousness, but I don't really believe it's true. Or as two friends were talking, I heard our friend Mr. Patel just became a high court judge. No, I don't believe it. It's not possible. Mr. Patel can come out here. I know that guy since, you know, we were kids. Couldn't become a high court judge. No, I was there in the court. I saw Mr. Patel, he was sitting there as a high court judge, and he was doing, you know, he was making decisions. All right, maybe he became a high court judge, but I'm sure they're not giving him any salary. So, all right, they look like they're devotees. They seem to be giving instructions like they're devotees. But I don't really believe that it's coming from Krishna, because they're too contaminated. Krishna couldn't possibly be telling us anything through them. So, with that such an attitude, no one will listen to us, and we won't listen to anyone else either. And we'll be lucky if we can actually get together and cooperate, even to make prasadam. So one has to try to see things from a spiritual point of view, and therefore honor all the devotees appropriately. Learn how to cooperate, respect devotees, learning how to free ourselves from the envious attitude against neophyte devotees, those who are less than us, and actually see those devotees who are higher than us, who have more realizations in spiritual life than we have, even in a particular way, and try to appreciate them and serve their instructions, and also try to serve them. Then we'll make some spiritual advancement, our society will go forward. So I'll stop there, thank you. Any questions? Yes?
You said, Maharaj, that we should judge also according to what previous acharyas gave us, and not take the credentials of devotees by their face value. I mean, not face value, but by some usual designations or by praise of other devotees. Or we should also.
No, that's for questions, right? Is that for the questions? Yeah. Is this being recorded?
Yeah.
So yes.
That means we should also use our intelligence for discrimination, but our intelligence is in illusion.
I hope it's not an illusion.
Okay.
Not 100% an illusion.
Okay.
So we have to use the intelligence coming from our disciplined succession, inspired by the super soul in our heart. In other words, Krishna is actually in our heart, the Dhamin Buddha Yoga Dham. And as much as we're sincerely trying to be steady in our service with enthusiasm and love, as much as we're trying to get proper spiritual vision and apply it appropriately, then Krishna will help us. It's all positive. There may not be any Mahabhagavats in our society according to our vision, but we have many devotees, all the devotees are following the Mahabhagavat, and therefore they're dear to the Mahabhagavat. If we want to serve Mahabhagavat, we also have to serve them appropriately. So it's all very positive. It's not that, well, you're not, I just learned from the class, he's telling us we're not, he's telling us there may not be any Mahabhagavats, I may not see, and it's all right. And therefore, the next devotee I look at, I think, is that a Mahabhagavat? Useless! Get out of my way! You're going to contaminate. Useless devotee. The search after the Mahabhagavat. As if the Mahabhagavat was not here in Prabhupada's instructions. He reasons ill who thinks that Vaishnavas die, without living still and sound, and Vaishnavas die to live and living spread the holy name around. Or even if we think someone is a Mahabhagavat, then they must be 100% in line with the teachings of the other Mahabhagavats. So it's not that we can't consider someone a Mahabhagavat, but we shouldn't blindly consider it. We should consider it after reviewing the teachings of the other Mahabhagavats. We consider Śrīla Prabhupāda a Mahabhagavat because he followed the teachings of Lord Chaitanya in disciple succession perfectly by spreading Krishna consciousness the way he did. He took up Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instruction. Whoever Prabhupada met, he tried to help them become Krishna conscious. That was his whole life. And everyone else can be judged accordingly. But if one is not as perfect in that as Śrīla Prabhupada, still everyone is, every single devotee within the society who's following Śrīla Prabhupada's instructions is, to some degree, or a large degree, connected with Śrīla Prabhupada and Krishna in disciple succession. And we should honor everyone appropriately. So the word is honor everyone and serve everyone, but do it appropriately under the guidance of the Absolute Truth, the perfect instructions coming down by the Mahabharata. Anything else? Hey, Rio. Brother Ashman,